to get caught on the wrong side of a safety car. So in comes the McLaren.
So this is cleansing the race. This is just setting everyone up for a one-hour sprint.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, nice of them to do that.
No, tyres, no tyres. I can't imagine tyres this time.
The smoke pouring off my computer. Trying to work out race strategy. Thank you, because this just makes it much easier to understand. Fuel, no tyres. See you later, Shane.
Now, why that's important, guys, is that he didn't need as much to get him to the end of the race because he'd already made that stop earlier. So, effectively, he's taking his splash and go right now, and that means that he now doesn't have to worry about his fuel numbers. All he has to worry about is the times and getting closer to the guys at the front of the field.
Let's watch for car number two, because track position at game here for Phoenix Racing.
Should be.
And clear.
Yeah,
exiting pit lane. The Phoenix Audi still running down into the final corner. Maguire's turn. They've still been in this, and that's got the McLaren to P3.
So now Guy Smith, we know, is going to hand over the number 10 Bentley to Stephen Kane. So they've got to jump shortly. And then what happens to the Nismo Nissan? Do they stay out? It will be Katsubasa Chiyo, I'm sure, to take it to the end. Do they roll the dice on any further intervention by the safety car?
Down here in the Phoenix pits with the most overdressed water boy.
So that would suggest if Guy Smith could get in and out quickly, he could keep that position. The problem is he can't get in, change drivers, and get out quickly enough, I don't think. Now, the 31 is in. That is not the leading Bentley. That is the car in eighth position.
As is the 75, so Rennie Rast comes down pit road, as does Maxime Soulet.
And they're actually, that is a battle for position on pit road. Look how big that Bentley looks on the Audi.
So this race is in a really interesting phase at the moment, isn't it?
So many places. So many places still up for grabs.
Because we're waiting for Nissan and Bentley to make their final move. But the further they go into this race, the less fuel they have to put in the final stop, the faster they can go in the final stint, and it just all starts to build in their favour.
The only problem for Bentley is if they want to put in Stephen Kane, that takes a little time. And if you just want to put a quick splash in, that's not going to work for you. To put Stephen Kane in without any disadvantage, you really need a full course yellow.
Where are they at on driver time with that? Well, do they have to put him in?
That's the issue.
Send one of the pit lane team down to find out about that, because I think that's the biggest question mark in the race.
Correct.
Because we've seen Florian Strauss do an enormous amount of work. Rick Kelly's done the same. So we're confident Chiyo can go to the end. And what better person to have at the end of the car, end of the race, than the guy who won it for them last year? I think the big question mark is now on car number 10 and Bentley, and whether they have to change drivers. If they do, it will cost them time. If they just put fuel in, they're going to be all right, because they've got 40 seconds back to the number 59 McLaren. Dry ice into the driver's cool seat. And the team that's been outstanding all day. And with all due respect to the five other cars run out of Melbourne Performance Centre this weekend, Audi Customer Sport Racing Australia, you'd have to say that car five probably not the one. And they would have admitted it too, I'd suggest, that you wouldn't have picked to finish first, but such has been the dramatics early on in the race.
Hey, by the way,
GT Motorsport's done a superb job.
The Bentley and that 75 Audi came in together. Bentley's gone by enough time to make a cup of tea and a 3-minute egg nearly before the 75 rolls again.
So the 31 car grabs eighth position
into the final hour of the Liqui-Moly Bathurst 12-hour. 270 laps completed, and that's 1,677 k's. We've gone further than we went in last year's race, admittedly with less safety car interruptions.
And Gisbergen flying into the 203. So is Nico Bastian back in fifth position. He's 25 seconds back from Lance Venture.
So let's just remind everyone, the number one Nissan needs to make a court along pit road for its final service. The number 10 in second place by just on 10 seconds needs to make a call along pit road for its final service and possibly a driver change. In third position, Shane Van Gisbergen is, we think, the first car in the 59 that could go all the way to the end of this year's 2016 Liqui-Moly Bathurst 12 hours.
Bentley setting up for one more stop, and this is for car 10. You guys are speculating if Guy was going to stick in that car and get it to the end. The answer to that one is no. It is going to be Stephen Kane getting back in that car to drive it to the flag.
Well, that's a good point, and that clarifies a lot, I think, in the final makeup of this race, because the added pit stop time it'll take to put the driver in with the fuel, I wonder if the Bentley might well drop a place, and it might be back to third. It could be to fourth to Lawrence Vanthoor in the Phoenix Racing Audi.
Well, Van Gisbergen has seen that possibility. He's under 203 now, 202.996 last time around.
202.9 on the 271st lap of a motor race at Mount Panorama. It's ridiculous. 48 seconds he is behind Chio. So it's going to be close when Chio stops.
Smithy then, does he come this time? Under the bridge, steers to the left-hand side, and here's the second-place car coming in. Guy Smith. Next question, are they going to put Stephen Kane in? Watch to see what happens with Guy as he comes under the bridge, the Liquid Molly Bridge just to our right. He's gone. Yeah, he's going for the straps. He's gone for the straps. It's going to be a driver change. I'd suggest they'll put tyres on this as well, because it will take them that long to get the car turned around. They may not, but they may feel that will give them just enough advantage in the last hour with 55 minutes still to go.
The 10 comes to a stop. It will be fuel and driver change only. They do not have Michelins ready to go for this car. They did put new ones on the 31, the sister car, but this will be a stop to fuel the Bentley all the way to the end and to get Stephen Kane back in. I wasn't able to find anyone to ask, but I will ask Guy Smith why he needed to get out of the car. The Bentley looks a little bit rattled, like it's been through the war, nothing as far as its sister car, and it can do it. The driver change is done. Guy Smith is already back across the line. Ooh. Fueling is done, and there goes Stephen.
Well, shame on me, as Van Giz has gone through. The Bentley team super quick on the driver change, so they got it done before the fuel hose came out. So no loss of time whatsoever. That means they haven't put Michelin tyres on that car, and that's the right decision, because that would have kept them in pit lane too long. And now Stephen Kane on used Michelins is on his outlap.
And Vanthoor is behind the 10 Bentley, and with one report from Twitter that the number two Audi has shown some light smoke.
And they did put oil into that at that last stop. We saw that go into the engine bay. This is interesting. So theoretically, those two stops with Van Gisbergen and Kane should have been the same time, because the fuel and the driver change took exactly the same time. Shane Van Gisbergen put a full tank in 45 seconds. Took Stephen Kane a minute and four. Assuming the Nissan can do it in the same time as Van Gisbergen, it's going to take 45 seconds. The margin first to second, 45 seconds. They'll be line ball.
Guy Smith, what was the thinking behind putting Stephen in the car and getting you out?
Well, with time, I was out of time. So we worked out so that I was going to do the last hour, the second last hour, and Stephen in for the end. So we'll see what he can do now. I mean, obviously, the race is pretty wide open. We're struggling a little bit with our car as it's got warmer. We're struggling for speed. So it's becoming more difficult, but we'll have to see what Stephen can do. He's always very good at the end of the race, so I've got every confidence in him.
That he is. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
So the reason, of course, that they were stationary longer was they needed more fuel in that car. Van Gisbergen had stopped more recently, so it was just a top back to the top of the tank rather than them having to put a bit more fuel in.
And the Nissan's going to need less fuel to get to the flag than anybody else.
Well, it's a timed stop for them.
Correct.
Effectively, they must not leave anything, and they must not put any more than is absolutely required in to get that car home. Somebody's going to have to do some very, very specific arithmetic and calculations so that they get exactly the right amount, not too much and certainly not too little. They can't afford a fumble on this fuel stop.
Van Gisbergen is taking time out of Geo into the 203s again. Last time, 204.2 for the Nissan man, 203.2 for the McLaren man. 44 seconds now the gap.
Remember, that last stop for Van Gisbergen was 45 seconds. So what we're talking about here is the motor race, theoretically, in that these two could come out side by side, in theory, out of pit lane. Depending on how good this Nissan stop is and how much fuel they have to put in, this could be absolutely line ball. McLaren to Nissan, and in comes Katsumasa Chiyo for the final stop for the defending champions. absolutely critical. He hits the pit lane limit perfectly, which he does. Don't take any risks.
No fumbles here. Got to get this absolutely right. I would be shocked to see anything other than the fuel hose come out. Maybe a tear off the screen. Van Gisbergen on the right-hand side of the screen already coming back towards the pit lane. They're having a look, checking the tyres, looking at the right-hand front, right-hand rear. That's the Michelin service one. He's checking through. Just as the fuel is going in, that's fine. Here's Van Gisbergen coming back towards the end of the lap. This is going to be mighty tight, guys. The Nissan is starting to come down.
This is going to be immense.
Van Gisbergen. And here comes Van Gisbergen. He's on the Liqui Moly pit straight.
He's going to clear him. Shane Van Gisbergen will go to the lead. Techno Autosport back in front with 50 minutes to go in the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour. Chio will be fine in second. It's a long way back to Stephen Kane in the M Sport Bentley.
But he's got traffic between them, and that's not what he wanted to see. Now, this time last year, of course, when we were counting down towards the end, not only did Chio have a very good car under him, but he was on tyres that had done quite a bit less work than the guys around him. He hasn't had the luxury of changing as he went to that last pit stop that time around. So he's going to have to go to the end with the Michelin tyres that he's got on. It's hot, but we know from talking to the team early on that this car just gets better as the tyres wear down and the rubber gets on the track.
And Van Gisbergen, by topping off with that other safety car just before, actually saved them a little bit of time, so they had the shortest pit stop of the four. That's why they've got that time.
Correct.
So in a weird way, they've had the strangest strategy of the day today, but it's actually paid off for them in the end with the way the safety cars have tumbled and this green flag running at the end.
There's only so much you can do, Creelsey. You can make some decisions, some like that Bentley stop to change to Stephen Kane, at least to have to put Stephen in the car. They are forced on you by the regulations. It's about getting the compromises between what you feel is your best strategy and what the regulations mandate you to do. You've got to get that compromise right. And obviously, how the dice falls, how the cards are played by everyone else and where those safety cars go. Techno made a mistake, but it hasn't cost them because there was a safety car after the pit lane speeding violation.
And behind this pair, we've got a battle for third position because Stephen Kane is just a second ahead of Lawrence Vanturre.
I suspect the Phoenix Racing Audi driver will find it very difficult to pass the Bentley.
You think?
Yeah, I do. Based on what we've seen today, I realise the simple nature of that statement from yours truly, but from what we've seen today and the relative performance of the two cars in a straight line in particular.
And here they are.
And they've got a McLaren between them in the shape of the number 60 car.
12 seconds, first to second. After 273 laps of motor racing, that's the margin. That's all we're playing with.
That's a stumble. It's, you know, getting stuck behind a couple of slow cars. It's certainly not enough to come down and do a drive-through. So you can't afford to upset the steward of the meeting here now. If you're in one of the top positions, it's going to take you 40-odd seconds to come down pit lane.
This has the potential to be immense, the final 47 minutes. What has Katsumasa Chio got to deliver?
So is it going to be a double for Nissan? Is it going to be the biggest win for McLaren in GT Racing since 1995?
Yeah, when, of course, the F1 won at Le Mans, F1 GTR. JJ Leto with that awesome stint during the night, in the wet, in the dark, with no cameras to record it, but those who watched his progress on the timing screens, which I have to tell you were far more rudimentary than what we've got now, they will never forget him unlapping himself and then driving away from the field. That is what Shane Van Gisbergen is up against now, the history of McLaren in GT Racing.
12 seconds, 33 seconds cover the top four. Third and fourth place split by 1 second. In the fight for the final spot on the podium, Phoenix Racing, second last year, would dream of being up there again after a very challenging day at the office. A lap back, and it suggests now probably out of contention for a win, is David Reynolds, P5 for Erebus Motorsport. The swan song for the SLS AMG at Mount Panorama. Sixth place, Nathan Antunes for GT Motorsport in the Audi. Will Davison is behind the wheel of the second McLaren. He's seventh. Andy Suchek, eighth in the second Bentley. They've had a good day, aside from all of the dramas that's been thrown at them. Garth Tander, ninth in the JMAC PEM Racing Audi. And Luke Yulden rounding out the top 10 in the JBS Racing Lamborghini.
203.9 for Shane van Gisbergen. 205.2 this time. Fortier. The gap goes out to 14 seconds.
Shane van Gisbergen on a slightly different setting now than he was earlier on. He leads the race. It's about speed and consistency, but no risks needed now because he is in the lead. They are controlling what is going on. They're being Techno Autosports McLaren and Shane van Gisbergen. The Kiwi leads it.
Now, for viewers in South Australia, Victoria and New South Wales, time for you to head across to Seven Mate to watch the end of the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour. So a reminder, if you're in South Australia, New South Wales, Victoria, head across to Seven Mate right now.
It's the last 45 minutes on the mountain for the Liqui Moly 2016 12 hours at Bathurst, and Shane van Gisbergen, the man who smashed the qualifying record on Saturday with the Kiwi orange and black McLaren, is at it again. Broke the lap record, fastest we've ever seen anything go around the mountain this morning, and it's led to some fabulous racing. Big tyre blowout for the Audi heading up the mountain, and that caused our 11th safety car period. It was good news for Van Gies, that actually, because it let him get back up to the back of the pack after he'd made a slight mistake in the pit lane and got pinged for speeding. It's been close, very close indeed. Van Gies has been on full out attack mode, and look how close the 82 Audi was to total disaster at the top of the mountain. Take a look again here. That's another car, not the same one, but almost the same result down in the pits. It's all been about getting things right. The Nissan was coming out, but not quick enough, and Van Gisbergen in the Techno Autosports McLaren is back at the front of the field. Bentley in third position now has Stephen Kane behind the wheel to take it to the flag. But the top three are separated by nothing at all as we head into the last 43 minutes.
So, what a race it's been, and the margins are so small at the end of a very long day at the office. That's how they run. Pirelli leading Michelin. Pirelli have been desperate to break Michelin's stranglehold on this race, and that tyre war has been a topic throughout the course of the weekend. Car 5, the Audi continues to lead the AM class and the Darrell Lee GT3 cars. The Groves in front in Rich's Class B. Very, very strong performance from them. And in the BM Pro Invitational class, it's the Jake Camilleri, Morgan Haber, and Aaron Seaton, Mark Cars Australia Mazda, that still tops the charts and running an outstanding 13th outright. So much to play for at Mount Panorama. The race is building up to a huge conclusion. You'll see it here live.
Magnificent stuff. And Van Gisbergen with less traffic now due to the retirement, and that I'm sure has contributed to the fact we've seen the safety car far left often this year, and no lack of quality at the front of the field, guys. So we've still got the same manufacturers, more than the same manufacturers we had last year. We've had more green flag racing, and we've still got a finish to be proud of here. And I'll take more green flag racing over more cars on the track any day of the week.
It's not done yet, because Gio has not given up this fight. He's matching Van Gisbergen more or less, 10th here, 10th there, sector per sector. Still 42 minutes to go. The gap is 13.8 seconds. And as you said, John, all that means is a bit of a cough or a stutter somewhere. Mantel, meanwhile, is right with Stephen Kane.
277 laps, which is 1,720 kilometres of racing today. It's more than the 2012 race, 270 laps and 2013 at 268. Record being 296, 1830 k's in a day is a long way. Did you know the distance? If you travelled 1830 k's from here, you'd end up about halfway to Perth. And if you went that far from New York, you'd end up at Des Moines, Iowa.
Fabulous.
These things I feel like you should know in an endurance race. You need to have some fun facts.
I think you've got to get out more.
Why is it you're not the only one that says that?
Great. Funny, isn't that?
Good one. Mm.
Minutes remain. 13.8 seconds the gap. And if anything, it's Chio that's at the moment on the move. Marginally, but on the move. He's taking a tenth here and a tenth there out.
40 minutes to go in the Liquid Moly 12 hour. So Shane van Gisbergen continues to lead. The margin pretty static at the moment. 13 seconds. 40 minutes to go. 276 laps into the race. What a walking wounded through this field as we keep an eye on the battle for third and fourth place between Bentley and Phoenix.
Yeah, so hopefully stays like that. He can be comfortable and pick his own pace and come home with a victory.
Who's your biggest danger?
Oh, definitely the Nissans. You know, they're been quick all day. The car's super fast on a straight line. The safety car comes, they'll, you know, I think we're quick across the top, but up and down the mountain, they're extremely quick. So, but we'll push on. You know, Shane's loving the car. He's been happy all day, as he was yesterday in qualifying. So, yeah, we'll just sit tight.
He's an amazing driver. He amazes us. Does he still impress you?
He's still as out of control as ever. We had 3 years at Techno to try and tame him in a V8, and that didn't happen, and certainly not going to happen in a McLaren either.
Don't shut him down. He's good. Good luck, Jono.
Thank you.
Says that with a smile because they had some great times together, did Jono Webb. He's done a really solid job today as Webby, former Porsche Carrera Cup Australia racer. Great success. Development Series champion in V8 supercars as well. And plenty of time in the main game. Continue that role. His team loses SVG to 888 and the Red Bull Commodore for the V8 supercars this year, but gains Will Davison. So not a bad swap in terms of driving capabilities.
Well, so this is game on because Gio has just taken a second and a half out of Van Gisbergen on the last lap. 11.7 seconds the gap now.
Yeah, don't count Gio out. Traffic is going to play a part here and there's not that much of it left now. So what we've got is a proper all-out battle. A lot of people tuned in around the world. Thanks to our international syndication and all talking about the purity of this race. Yes, we've had the safety car out there, but the safety car procedures are simple and quick here on the mountain. And thanks to our race director and the supplementary regulations, we get back to green flag very quickly. And that has been enjoyed by everyone from Europe to the US and indeed further afield. And what we've got now is the two best drivers, the two fastest guys of the weekend, at it at the head of the field. Stephen King trying to get on terms with them. Three different cars in the top three, four different cars in the top four, five different cars in the top five.
It's certainly fair to say there's nothing, no, it's no less engaging this race than in 2015. What it is, it's got more flow because we've had less interruption, and that certainly has been a very welcome development for 2016.
The battle for third place is absolutely on here, and once again Lawrence Vantor finds himself jammed up behind that big rear wing of a Bentley Continental GT3, and he gets to this point and goes because just doesn't quite have the straight line performance. He's going to have to do something mega across the top.
That is a battle for position, as you can see on the screen. We're going to take our last break from the action for those of you watching on 7 or 7 Mate here in Australia. When we come back, we'll take you all the way to the checkered flag at the end of the 2016 Liquid Moly Bathurst 12 hours. Don't go too far away. For those of you on the international stream, a reminder that Michelin Post Race Tech will follow the checkered flag. We'll stay for the podiums. It's a fairly brief affair, the podium ceremonies here. And then we'll get straight into PRT. The hashtag is Michelin PRT. And that's to at Radio Le Mans on Twitter, please. And also hashtag SOTR for your spirit of the race to at Radio Le Mans. I've got a feeling I know who that one might be, but I'll leave that to the dear listeners. So stay tuned at the end. I know it's been a long haul, but we'll get Graham to stay on Creelsey for a little while before he does the press conference. And as soon as I get back from wrapping up the TV programme, I'll join in as well. You'll hear the dulcet tones of Johnny Palmer driving the Michelin Post Race Tech Show from back in London, and he can give us his perspective on the race as he's been up watching it all as well. Very early in the morning, it might be a slightly tired sounding JP. That is straight after the second set of podiums, main podiums live on the TV. We'll stay on for the second set of podiums, and then we'll head to Post Michelin Post Race Tech. Hashtag Michelin PRT comes straight after the race. Lots of talking points from this, including what we've just been talking about with the safety car procedures. I'd like to know what you think also about the relative performances of the brands of cars. We've had the top seven filled with seven different manufacturers at various times this weekend. I'm sure nobody's going to say anything bad about the circuit. Bathurst and Mount Panorama are iconic. What about the racing that you've seen today in all three classes? The BM Invitational class, it is still the Mark Cars Australia number 93. Jake Camilleri is back at the wheel of that car. He leads from Anthony Alford in the Donut King Ford in second, the 54 car in third. Adrian Morrell in the Mark Cars Australia number 92. In Class B, Scott McLaughlin leads in the Grove. Higher car has just gone across the line. The number four red and white Porsche is ahead of the safety stock Porsche in second, the six car, the JFC Fleet Rotex Porsche, the 21 car, with Richard Gardner and Daniel Studdard at the wheel of those two Porsches. That is the Ridges Class B and the BM Pro Invitational Class. At the head of the field in Darrell Lee Class A, Shade van Gisbergen has an 11 second lead over the rest of the field, headed up by Katsumasa Chio. And this one is by no means over. It won't be over until we see the checkered flag. You know that. That's the way of things here at Bathurst. They just go right to the end.
Back at Mount Panorama for the Liqui-Moly Bathurst 12-hour. There's 32 minutes remaining. We're 281 laps into this race. 1,745 k's done and dusted. The margin, 11 seconds. That's it between Shane van Gisbergen and Katsumasa Chio. Stephen Kane under pressure from Lawrence Vantor. The margin, 7 tenths in the fight for the final spot on the podium. All the way through to the flag, John Hindhoff and Graham Goodwin alongside me. It's been a remarkable day with so many stories to talk about, and there might still be some more to write at the end of this one.
Well, there's one place that Bentley won't want to be this year, and that's fourth. And last year's effort here sparkled, but ultimately they were, I guess you could say, they were robbed at the final turn there. But Stephen Kane...
Well, they would have said they were mugged, wouldn't they?
Yep. He's got one job, and that's bring it home, and bring it home as high of the field as you possibly can. 27 seconds back from Chao, and Chao is holding that gap to van Gisbergen.
Nobody should have any worries about fuel, because they all stopped at a chosen time, not when they were forced to. They all stopped when they wanted to, and they put in as much fuel as they felt they needed. So if anything goes wrong on that front, there's no one to blame but the teams themselves. So in theory, guys, everybody should be turned up to 11 in terms of the fuel map and should be pushing absolutely as hard as they can. They're all on at least one stint plus old tyres, so that's pretty even as well. So now it's just going to be down to the nut at the end of the steering wheel and what performance that they can wring out of these three very different cars at the head of the field.
Interestingly enough, the car in fourth place has made the least amount of pit stops out of anybody in contention. 8 stops for the Phoenix Racing Audi, 13 times through the lane for Shane van Gisbergen. And the Nissan and the Bentley, 11 times apiece.
Well, the Phoenix car, of course, tried to stay out to get laps back and therefore have not always topped the tank off. And that's rather being forced on them. The race has come back to them and they might be the unluckiest team of all. They're 1.3 seconds behind a podium position at the moment, but it just appears to me that Laurent Vanthoor has given that up, Graham.
No, meantime, in the for the lead, the hurry-up call has certainly come to Chio because he's taken a second down to Van Gisbergen in the first two sectors of this lap. They're going to cross the line.
Yeah, this is good stuff. Chio starting to wind himself up now in the fight for the lead. What sort of lap does he do? 4-5 for Van Gisbergen.
3-0.
Fastest lap for the car today. Katsumasa Chio is starting to close the margin down to Shane van Gisbergen. Under 10 seconds.
Crazy, this is what he did last year, if
correct.
You remember. It was like they'd flicked a switch in the last 35, 40 minutes. Maybe they've asked him to do exactly that again. They'll have run the numbers, they'll have run them again, and then just three times for luck to make sure that their fuel calculations were right. And now they've turned him up to full attack mode. And the number one car, defending champions on the mountain, is on and up the hill, and he's on it. And Shane van Gisbergen will get the call. It's down to 9.882 seconds. The advantage nowadays, of course, you don't have to wait to go past the pits to see how far the guys were back in the old days. But I remember it was a pit board hanging out. They'll have been on the blower to him on the telephone, straight into his ears and saying, Chio is coming, and he's coming quickly.
He's coming very quickly. Half a second more in the first sector from Chio. The gap is down to 9.5.
What a time for Chio Sun to start stepping things up in the Nissan. Rick Kelly looks very nervous watching on. Doesn't matter what race it is at Bathurst, when it gets this late in the stage, you're in with a shot, the nerves must be absolutely there.
Look, there's not a lot we can do. Shane's very, very quick, there's no doubt about that. He's maintaining, you know, around a 10 to 12 second gap there. We know that if he wants to push, he'll go into the 202s pretty comfortably. So for us, all we can do is try our best, and Chio's doing a great job of that. Obviously, just got the fastest lap of the race for our car, which is impressive, but it's a pretty big gap to try and close up in just a few laps.
He's a pretty crazy dude, isn't he, Chio? We saw what he achieved last year. He's just such an excitable guy.
Yeah, but as far as the driver goes, he's really exceptional as well. Looking at the data and him getting the most out of the car, it's been really good learning. Weekend for me to see what he can do in this car around this track is very impressive. So it's a good thing he's in the car now to finish off as strong as we possibly can.
A lot of nervous energy down here at the Nismo team. Nissan trying to go back-to-back at the mountain just like they did in the early 90s.
Van Gisbergen responds, Chad, with a 203.4, but Chio still took 3.5 tenths out of the lead last time round. He'll fall short if he does it at 3.5 tenths a lap. But with lap traffic and the way it ebbs and flows around this 6.2Ks, it might go quicker.
When did the McLaren stop? What was that lap that they stopped? Or how long did they have to go? They were just on the
hour mark, 266, wasn't it? So yeah. 267.
So they've done 20. They'll be doing 24. Yeah, okay, I think they can do that.
You're suggesting there may be a concern in the back of their mind about just saving a little bit.
I think
in
so.
This final hour.
I think at this point, you don't do anything silly. You leave Van Gis out there doing. If he can do the threes through traffic, that's going to be fine. We know he can go quicker, but that's a turbocharged engine. It'll burn fuel. The turbo on Nissan will also be burning fuel, but they stop much later, and they put as much fuel in it as they felt they were going to need. Here's the traffic that's going to be the problem for both of these guys. It's Chio who's going to deal with it now.
SVG copped it at the top of the hill, so it'll even itself out over the course of the lap. Although I think Chio actually got the worst of it because he's dropped 2 seconds in the middle sector.
Sometimes getting information out of the techno guys, well, to be honest, you might need some kind of water torture techniques. But thankfully, Alvaro Brent was happy to tell me that they're pretty confident that they can get home on the fuel that they've got. They filled that car all the way to the brim. They brought it back in. They filled it up again. So there was no short fill there to try and get track position. But two things about this. On Friday, that team ran endless amounts of laps every single time checking fuel data, chatting to Will Davison in the sister McLaren in the 60. He was fascinated at just how much work and how much attention they pay to that. So they knew exactly how many laps they'd be able to get out of a tank, how long they'd be able to run at the end of this race. That is some pretty fine mathematics to get that thing home. So I won't be too worried about that. The other thing I want to mention, guys, remember that fuel rig swap? They said that would take about 6 to 7 seconds out of each pit stop. And how close is that gap between first and second?
Oh,
it's the one percentage, John, that makes such a difference.
Absolutely right. So the Optimum guys are on for a big, big Barbie and beer bill at the end of this one. If this comes through, their misfortune, and they went out of the race with the rear wheel tucked under on that car on the left-hand side. Immediately, the thought was the faster-filling fuel rig needed to come down to the 59 car. And that will have saved them a lot of time. Far more than they've got in hand. It's gone back out to 13 seconds, fellas.
Yep, slower lap last time. Traffic in the second and third sectors for the Nissan. 12.9.
The McLaren camp is thinking now. The nerves start to creep in when you get this close. 285 laps in. You get 15 laps in 25 minutes? Probably not. McLaren have history at Mount Panorama. An amazing Australian driver by the name of Neil Allen held the outright lap record here in McLaren for a long time. It was set in 1979. If I remember, it wasn't broken until the 2000s.
The battle, gentlemen, may well be for the last step on the podium. If we just keep an eye on what's going on at the head of the field, of course we will. But Stephen Kane has got Laurent Vanthoor trying to close him down, and they're trading tenths of seconds as well, as through comes the McLaren. That car looks absolutely immaculate. It looks exactly as it did when it started the race. There's no dings, there's no bent bits, there's no tape, there's nothing falling off it. And that's, of course, how you win endurance races.
203.4 for Van Gisbergen that time round, 3.8, 13.3 seconds. Here's the margin, just ebbs and flows in traffic. 23 minutes to go, tension building. McLaren edging ever closer. Nissan looking for a defence. Steve Hallam, speaking of McLaren, used to work for them in a Formula One perspective. Wealth of knowledge and brought over to Australia. Looked after the Holden Racing Team for some time and now across, based up in Queensland with Techno Autosport looking after their operation, and that's an expanding team of V8 Supercar for Will Davison. Three McLarens in Australian GT this year, and he's the success that team's had in V8 racing over the last 3 years has been attributed to his leadership in building that team.
There is something just entirely appropriate about seeing a Nismo GTR across the top of the mountain, isn't it? When you're of a certain age and you remember the original Godzillas around here, the car that was so good it was legislated out of motorsport. And Nissan and Nismo back with a bang last year in the best possible way. The V8 Ultima, the parallel program in V8 Supercars.
So the 30th of March 1970 it was, Neil Allen in McLaren F5000 car did his 2:09.7 pre-Caltex chase. So it was over 2K straight down to what is now Maguire's Murray's Corner. Chio gets past the Castrol Mark Cars Australia entry. That lap record stood for a very, very long time and remained the fastest lap.
That was a Formula 5000 car, which correct. Would have been on slicks, which would have had a huge amount of power and would have had about a third of the weight of these machines, and these are GTs built from street cars. All right, let's go through that. I'm just put that in perspective for you there, dear viewer and listener. Let's go through the classes in the Riches B class. The Grove Motorsport car took control of that at about three quarter distance, maybe a little further back through the race, and Scott McLaughlin has really enjoyed his endurance racing this weekend, along with Earl Bamber and Steve Grove, the man who owns the car. They have got a significant gap back to the rest of the B-class runners. It's the safety stop, number six Porsche in second, Richard Gardner in turn. Daniel Studdard in the GFC Freem Rotax car in third, that's the 21 car. In the BM Pro Invitation class, the I category cars, Mark Cars Australia had all five of the top places at one stage, still hold positions one, two and three. And Jake Camilleri is the man at the moment behind the wheel of the leading car, the Darrell Lee stick sponsored machine. Second place, his teammate Tony Alford in the Donut King car, then Mark Cars Australia's Hadrian Morrell in the 92 in third position. And in fact, they're back into all five of the top places again, with James Vernon in the 91 and Jared McLeod, even after that horrible puncture in the right rear, has the 94 car back into fifth position.
And that just goes to show just how serviceable that car is, doesn't it? What have we got here?
We've got an off for the number five car, which is leading the Darrell Lee Class A AM part of the GT3 category.
Six overall.
Nathan Antunes, the GT Motorsport guys will be absolutely delighted. That is a change for position, James.
That's a change for eighth position, because Garth Tander has gone by Will Davison. Garth Tander in the number 75 Jamek Pem Audi. Not the day that that team wanted.
And more frustratingly for them than the issues that have put it back down the field, I would suggest, Creelsy, is that when Garth Tander was up behind the leaders trying to get a lap back, he was every bit as quick as the cars that were fighting for the top four or five places. So it's a case of what might have been for this car.
Yeah, they've been good today. They've been really good. I think they'll be proud of their effort. They'll be frustrated and disappointed because they had a realistic shot at a podium finish. Interestingly enough, Scott McLaughlin's just brought the Richards Class B leader back into pit lane for a top-off just to make sure they're going to get to the end of the motor race. Yeah, oh, they'll be disappointed for sure. It's been a good drive for Garth Tander, still punching out very good lap times. And Steve McLaughlin, who hasn't been racing for a huge amount of time, especially in these highly specialised, highly skilled GT cars, has done a very good job today. And that GT3 AM battle as well has been really good. And Greg Taylor, who's the AM driver in that number five Adena Property Group entry, has been a very, very worthy performance at this point in time. They've got three laps up on their nearest driver, which is Roger Largo's JBS Racing Lamborghini.
Stephen Kane in third position has managed to eke out the 7.2 seconds that will give him just a little bit of a breathing space for that third place on the podium. I think the fourth car coming in, by the way, Grilsey, was Scotty getting out and the car owner, Stephen Grove, being given the honour of bringing it to the line. That's what I would have done.
Good call.
He did say that's what would happen. He said about an hour ago that they're given the opportunity. They've got a 16-lap lead in that class because of just an epic Ironman, three-man Ironman stints with the number four car, number 60 car, meanwhile, on pit road.
So they've got a lap up on the JBS Lamborghini, 9th and 10th on the road. Will Davison behind the wheel, just sitting in pit lane.
Are they sucking a penalty up there, guys?
No one's touching the car.
Stop and hold penalties aren't particularly common. Fire up and go.
Or not.
9th place on the road for this car. It's had a troubled day. They will hold that position, though.
I'm going to suggest that that's not in first gear.
I'm going to suggest that that's not firing at all cylinders.
Yeah.
Imagine life as a windshield at Mount Panorama 2. I'm not sure exactly how Will Davison's seeing out of that, but nevertheless, especially through right-hand corners, looking across to the apex.
So 17 minutes remain, and Shane van Gisbergen has been pulling away gradually from the Nissan. All of a sudden, though,
Chio's not done yet, Graham. 2:03:03, fastest lap for that car of the day. Not giving up. Because at Mount Panorama, you just never know. There's still 16 minutes to go as we still hear that front splitter scraping on the ground.
Well, they run them effectively now like a formula car. You're running zero ride height. You basically jack the car up just enough so that it clears the ground on the bumpy bits.
Led 93 laps today, Techno Autosport. The Nissan in that middle stint, or later middle stint of the race, sort of hours 6 till 9, eked their way in front. 107 laps led for car one. They've led a bulk of the running today. There's 200 laps between those two cars. The Bentleys, both of them have shared the lead. Car 36, the Erebus SLS, was out in front early, and car 63, they led a couple of laps during one of those early pit stop shuffles. But 107 laps in front for car number one. Techno drawing ever closer to that number as they start lap 290. The gap constant at 13.7 seconds. Chio takes another half a second out of the lead that time round. He's doing everything he can. He needs some help from something, someone, somewhere to help close that margin to Shane van Gisbergen. Stephen Kane has eked away from Lawrence Vantor. Was going to take something amazing from Vantor to get that podium position away.
So car 60, the sister McLaren's been chasing a little gremlin all day, and they've had to do a couple of little reboots on it. So that's all that was with Will coming into the pits to get that car restarted. Now, you could say that you could just do that on the racetrack and save yourself the time of having to come down pit lane like we saw Alvaro Parent do earlier. Now, why would you not do that on the racetrack, guys? Because if it doesn't restart, you bring out the safety car and you cost the other car a potential win. So wise thinking to just do that reboot in the pits, even if it does cost them an extra 40 seconds.
Yeah, and that's actually not the standard operating procedure. You picked up on a cracker there, because teams would rather do it out on the track when you've got the issue with everything running, rather than having to put it onto the pit lane speed limiter and add another variable into the potential electrical gremlin. We've seen it even as high up as the LMP1 cars at Spa and Le Mans, with Porsche preferring Romain Dumas to do that Control-Alt-Delete while he was rolling on the pit, on the racetrack, rather than bringing it down in the pit. So that is a change of normal operating procedure from the McLaren teams working together at the front of the field, and brilliantly picked up by Chad down there in the pits.
It's a good spot. This is up at the top of the racetrack at the elbow. Taking liberties where he can. With just a few minutes to go in the race, and this from on board. Think quick, Chio, think quick. And that's what he did.
Think quick, steer quicker. That's remarkable, isn't it?
These guys operate at such a high level.
Their clock speed is different to everyone else's. It's as simple as that in IT terms. 60 is out, but not up to speed. As through goes Laurent Vantur.
The battered Bentley behind them.
Now, that Bentley could do his teammate a bit of a favour here by getting through. Andy Suchek gets through between, in front of that Audi, and he puts himself between that car and Stephen Kim, who granted has pulled out 7 seconds, but I think the M Sport team would like to see a little more green and white between those two cars.
Phoenix Racing have shown their class today. 2012 winners of this motor race with Chris Meese, Chris de Jonts and Darryl O'Young. I know Darryl's watching. He loves this place. He's won it twice, this motor race, and we'll be back next year, he tells us, with a couple of Porsche GT3Rs. Most things should be weapons at this place.
Darryl Young is, I saw him here yesterday. He was cruising the paddock, and here is the pass. Now, this is not for position, but significant in terms of protecting third place for the sister Bentley.
I suspect the Audi's tyres have done.
Yeah.
It's just unable to respond to the pace of the Bentley ahead.
It was going to take some kind of move to get the job done, because he was going to have to do it at the cutting and between the cutting to the elbow, and then risk being passed again in a straight line. But where they've been so classy is their strategy. They've completed three less pit stops than the two cars in front of them on the road, and they've kept themselves in the game by being smart, by being consistent, with a couple of really good driving stints as well. It's a pleasure to watch. Lawrence Vantor, Winkelhock was epic. Alex Davison contributed well. Just such an amazing team. May they keep coming back to this place time and time again, because that's going to be good fun.
We talk crazy, don't we, about how in a 12-hour race, getting pole position doesn't normally make a lot of difference. How many times has the pole sitter won
only twice
here?
The leading car has gone on to win the motor race. And in both occasions, by no means has it been comprehensive. So,
4 minutes left, and Chio takes a second out of the lead.
It's remarkable they're still doing the times they are after 290-odd laps of Mount Panorama. And if you'd suggest to somebody, anybody in this pit lane, that you'd be punching out mid-203s after 290 laps of the 12-hour race. You said that 3 or 4 years ago, you'd be laughed at.
Oh, you would have been laughed at. You'd have been carted away by men in white coats.
And the resurfacing of the circuit 24 months ago helped the cause, yes. But the pace of development in GT3 racing is unbelievable. And we spoke yesterday about the goalpost being moved with what Shane Van Gisbergen did for pole, and they continue to be so.
And don't forget, there is a tyre war. Two different companies here supplying tyres. It's not a spec tyre, so you don't have to. You can't be as conservative as you might want to be as a tyre supplier when it's a single manufacturer. And Pirelli have pulled out the stops, bringing the special VLN tyre that was tested last year in Germany for the rounds on the Nordschleife. That's what they've supplied to their customers here. They knew they needed something special to take on the might of Michelin around here. And that is why battles between teams and suppliers are always good for not just the motor racing, but also for us at the end of the day, because this is a laboratory at 300 kilometres an hour for Pirelli, and the Bentley, the same for Michelin. Through comes the Grove car. Stephen Grove behind the wheel of that machine, the Grove Hyatt car. That is a big party in prospect as well.
The tension up and down the garage is immense, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Because it's still tense. In 11 seconds, we've become accustomed to these last lap shootouts at Mount Panorama. But we need to remember, they've been racing for 12 hours. 11 seconds covering two cars after 12 hours and 40 seconds covering four of them is unbelievable. It shows how competitive this race has been and how deep the field is that we could even get to that point and talk about the race changing hands in the final half an hour. Because endurance races of old, you'd be winning by six laps.
Yeah.
And we'd be inventing things to think about. Tension down in the Nismo camp. Great collaboration between the UK, Australia and Japan to put this program together. And should they end up second, it's certainly no dishonour after a victory last year. It's not a bad defence of your Bathurst title.
They will look back on the early sessions, I think, at Nissan and just wonder why they couldn't get the balance of the car better in those early sessions. Qualifying 13th ultimately didn't hurt them that much, but there was clearly something not quite right with that new car. That's not the same car that won last year. There have been some revisions and perhaps there's still a little learning process, but it will be back next year. Nissan Australia have bought the car and it will race again at this race in 12 months' time, and we hope to see it out in some of the late season Aussie GT races. That's the gap between first and second. That's what it looks like on Conrod Straight.
It didn't look the force that it was in 2015 for much of the week, did it, the GTR, but it came into its own during the race. And Chio has been magnificent in pursuit of Shane Van Gisbergen, a man that, let's face it, guys, has been a level apart of the rest of the grid.
Can you remember any fumble or mistake by the Nissan?
No, and as far as I can recall, they've only been passed on track once or twice today. A couple of times in pit lane, hasn't quite worked, but they've been immense. Unbelievable performance, 11.8. Chio takes more time out, and he's still going very close to the personal best lap of the car.
7 minutes.
The fact Van Gisbergen did a 201.5 on lap 23 was another. The lap after that, he did a 1.6, so he backed up that. He's the only car to do a 2 minute and one in a motor race at Mount Panorama
ever.
And he did a couple of them, and that showed their superiority. That was just a warning early on this morning that, bang, we've got this if we need it.
How big is this going to be for McLaren, Graham? You mentioned that they haven't won any of the really big international races since 1995. The whole of the GT programme is at Woking.
It's going to be huge because McLaren's first effort at GT3, great-looking car, but really wasn't quite the full ticket. Though we saw the car have some fantastic runs, including here. But this is a whole different ballgame. And what they're looking for is a 200-mile-an-hour billboard, and that's exactly what they've got here.
Ashley Bettinger has tweeted in using the hashtag B12HR. What's the marks on the windows, the windscreens of the techno cars? It's just a little place where
see them there. They've either got some dirt on it or it's a little bit of dirt that's got under the two layers of the tear-offs. You can still see this tear-offs if you look to the extreme left-hand side of the windscreen. You can see a little dark triangle there. That's where the mechanic would get hold of it and peel off the thin film. And that's either just a little bit of dirt that's on there that they haven't wiped off, or it's just got between the two layers and they've just sort of delaminated the two very thin layers of plastic.
And these windscreens with the tear-offs are actually built in
together.
In one piece, or what they don't do is fit the tear-offs to an old windscreen.
No, that's right. The windscreen is out of the car and the tear-offs sometimes up to six or seven different layers, which have to be, of course, absolutely optically correct. It's a very, very skilled job to get it done.
10.2 seconds, but only 5 minutes remain now.
He's going. He's Chio. 203.2 last time round. It's only 0.2 slower than his best lap of the motor race. We should mention McLaren and Borden Army with them here. 15 people from the UK, including a lot of the head honchos of their GT program. Andrew Cocotti, who's raced in this race, is here. Baz Linders, who's taking over their GT program, is here. Dave Eden, who's the head of PR for McLaren Road Cars and their GT program, is here. So they've brought this in force, and it's been an amazing result. It's the first time they've thrown everything they've got at this race. They've had a toe-in-the-water exercise for the last couple of years with Tony Quinn's team. It's a privateer entries, two-car team, Techno Autosports partnering up. It's been an enormous, enormous program.
If we go to the end of the race, we'll have done an hour and 19 minutes safety car free. Already we're at the second longest green flag stint, and we have seen the cars performing to their best along with the teams and drivers.
29 different lead changes in the race. That is a record for the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour between eight different cars.
And Chio still pushing the fastest first sector for the car. If these guys are going down, they're going to go down with honour.
Yeah, it's insane, isn't it? There's margin 10 seconds.
It's under that now.
You can never give up at Mount Panorama.
People tuned in around the world to the last 3.5 minutes. Our thanks to our streaming partners for superb international stream that has garnered compliments and comments from literally around the globe, taking the 2016 Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 hours to a bigger global audience than ever before, as well, of course, as being flag to flag here in Australia on 7 and 7, mate. And still the Bentley pushing on with 11 seconds to go. 2.029 for Chio.
8.4 seconds with 3 minutes remain.
1.7 seconds out of Shane Van Gisbergen last time round. He is going down swinging. Fastest lap of the car for the day on lap 295. We're on the 296th lap. At the end of this lap, we equal the most number of laps completed in the motor race.
And this is why this is such a fan favourite. They race with spirit, and Chio's doing exactly that with 2.5 minutes remaining. Two laps it will take now to complete this motor race.
We've had the fastest ever competitive lap in both qualifying and the race. We're going to have the longest distance completed in a 12-hour race on the mountain. This truly has been a record-breaking and new record-setting edition of the race, with more fans to witness it than ever before. That's another one to chalk off. And the 2016 Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 hours is going into the history books. This event has turned a corner. It's international and global in every sense of the word. Look at the drivers, look at the manufacturers who are in the top positions. McLaren, from Nissan, from Bentley, from Audi, from Mercedes-Benz, the top five.
Chio has taken 2.3 seconds out of the leader in the first two sectors of this lap. Yes, Shane Van Gisbergen will be in more or less a cruise mode to get home, but it's going to be a lot closer than we thought. There he is. That's the gap. It's visual.
So this should be the start of the last lap for Shane Van Gisbergen. As he comes through, there's 1 minute and five to go.
It's 5:43 local time, plus one lap. Here comes Chio. What time does he do? It's a 2:02.46.
It's 5 seconds. 5 seconds for the final lap of the 2016 Bathurst 12 hour.
You can almost see him. He's just over the brow. You just won't be able to see him.
Surely not. Surely not. 297th lap of the motor race. A record.
There could be no stumble from Van Gisbergen here with traffic. And Chio is on an absolute tear up Mountain Straight through Griffins. Again, the script writers have come up with an absolute classic. If you wrote this down, they'd call it fiction as they're going up the hill now for what we believe is the final time. And Chio is within sight now. The marshals are clapping Van Gisbergen. Van Gisbergen is enjoying the evening sunshine. And Chio-san is still keeping him honest.
1.3 seconds closer in the first sector. The gap now down to under 4 seconds.
And Chio is coming hard. Has he just timed this to perfection? Shane Van Gisbergen. Surely this can't be taken away from Techno now. He's got a clear run ahead of him. Not much traffic to trim him up now, Krilzy.
Confirming final lap. Into the elbow for the final time. Shane Van Gisbergen for Techno Autosports McLaren. You can see the Nissan in the rearview mirror.
It's another second go in the second sector.
Chio is absolutely flying.
He's
can
catching
Van Gisbergen erase the memories of Techno in 2014?
The teams are on the pit wall. Everyone is on the Luc de Mollys start-finish straight. Van Gisbergen will be able to see the bright white headlights. He's got three corners as he comes through the Caltex chase for the last time. He'll just come down the hill towards Maguire's. The crowd, you can hear the crowd over the noise of the racing cars. Shane Van Gisbergen can kick out the clutch. He's going to win it, but just Techno take it in 2016.
What a motor race. Chio across the line.
1.2 seconds. 1.2 seconds. What an astonishing end to that race.
That is amazing. Chio threw everything he had at Shane Van Gisbergen. He fell 1.2 seconds short. What a motor race.
To complete the podium.
Stephen Kane for Bentley. Denied in the final corner last year. Agonisingly close to a podium on debut at Mount Panorama. The famous British mark. Well, they're going to bounce back with Matt Bell and Stephen Kane. Amazing stuff. Shay.
Jono Webb, that was much closer than we thought it would be. Your heart was beating like crazy, but congrats, you've won the 12 Hours of Bathurst. How are you feeling?
Oh, it's amazing. I mean, couldn't keep the butterflies down for the last hour or two. Once we had that last stop, we were pushing on. And look, Shane drove amazingly. All the boys have done a fantastic job, and hey, what an awesome introduction for Techno to McLaren GT.
Congrats, and can't wait to hear from Shane.
Thank you.
Last time we saw a major endurance race won by McLaren was 2012, the Barcelona 24 Hours. We've seen wins in sprint racing in the United States and in Europe. But the last time we saw a race bigger than this one by the guys from Woking, it was 1995, and it was the Le Mans 24 Hours. What lies ahead for that grand British mark?
Yannick Delmas and JJ Leto, part of that.
And Masinori Sakaya.
Correct, yep. As part of that squad, an amazing victory. Bentley on the podium. So that's an enormous result as Shane Van Gisbergen brings the 59 car. He set the qualifying lap record, the fastest ever lap of Mount Panorama. Yesterday in qualifying, he won the Alan Simonson Pole Award. He's broken the outright lap record in today's motor race.
You have to say that was an absolutely magnificent race. And made at the very end there by the fighting spirit of Nissan. The Nissan GTR and Katsumasa Chio, but this man has just bossed it all weekend.
Yeah,
what a race!
It's been an inspiring performance from him, and the way he's driven this racing car and asserted his authority when he needs it. Beretta's got the winner.
Well, Shane Van Gisbergen, what an incredible weekend it's been, from pole position through to lap records for the race and through to the win tonight. What a gutsy driving effort it's been by you. Congratulations.
Just thanks to the team. The car has been fastest all weekend, so to win that on strategy and then pace, it's amazing. So thanks to the guys, thanks to Jonathan and Alvaro. Big heart in the mouth moment when it stopped earlier, but she hung on for the rest of the weekend, so awesome.
It's a real fighting effort all day. Tell me about that Nissan coming up behind you. Were you aware of the Nissan closing?
Yeah, we had him covered. So anytime he did a lap, I just stuck the knife in and did the same. So just got it to the end. Bloody great.
How good was this car?
Oh, it's awesome. This is the car I raced in Europe. So she's a beauty.
All right, let's have a moment, catch up with John on the team. Well done.
Navarro Parent gets a Bathurst victory as well on his debut on Wonderful. The mountain. What a performance. Five different brands in the top five for the second time in 2 years at Mount Panorama. And McLaren becomes the fifth different brand from six GT encounters on the mountain. So the diversity continues. Confirm the final results. It was McLaren, and we should mention the first win for Pirelli here as well. They threw everything they had at this weekend, and they delivered in the end. A runner-up result for the defending champions, and Bentley finally on the podium. Phoenix Racing, former winners, fought like anything and got home in fourth. And one lap behind in the final race for the SLS AMG for Erebus Motorsport in P5 was David Reynolds. Some walking wounded throughout the field, but a superb 12th outright for the Ridges Class B winner, Stephen Grove, Scott McLaughlin and Earl Bamber. The Mark Cars Australia car finished line astern with them for BM Pro Invitational. Jack Camilleri, Morgan Haber and young Aaron Seaton get to Bathurst victory. Seaton wins at Bathurst. That's got a certain ring about it, doesn't it? 21 finishes from 36 starters, a bruising race in the end, and a lot of tale of woe to talk about. And there'll be some long faces drowning their sorrows later on tonight, including the 2014 winners. Marinello Motorsport essentially outed.
Our outright winners in third place, Matt Bell, Guy Smith and Stephen Kane for Bentley Team M Sport. In second place, Florian Strauss, Katsumasa Shiyu and Rick Kelly for Nismo Athlete Global Team. And in first place, for Techno Autosport, Jonathan Webb, Alvaro Parent, and Shane Van Gisbergen. With the third place trophy is the Mayor of Bathurst, Gary Rush. With the trophy for second place is Bruce Morrison, Managing Director of Motor Active. And with the winner's trophies, the Honourable Paul Toole, Minister for Local Government and State Member for Bathurst. Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour podium.
Oh, what a great celebration and well earned by Jono Webb and the team.